Good evening, and welcome. I want to thank all of you for coming here this evening and to join NYU Law School in this tribute to Judge Diane Wood. Each year, the NYU Annual Survey of American Law dedicates its forthcoming issue to an individual who has made a significant contribution to the legal field. And we've had the honor over the years of featuring Supreme Court Justices Scalia and Breyer, Judge Posner of the Seventh Circuit, Judge Wald of the DC Circuit, as well as leading academics, including Anthony Amsterdam, Arthur Miller, and the late Derek Bell and Ronald Dworkin. This is an exciting moment for me, as it's my first year as dean, and so it's my first opportunity to introduce an annual survey dedicatee. It's also my first opportunity to say the word dedicatee. I really couldn't be more pleased to provide this particular introduction to a truly spectacular judge, scholar, teacher, and friend of the law school. And I'd like to thank our students at the annual survey who have chosen to dedicate the 71st volume to Judge Diane Wood, Chief Judge of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit and a senior lecturer at the University of Chicago Law School. I'm delighted the annual survey has chosen to recognize her significant accomplishments and in doing so, to have brought together such a remarkable group of friends, family, and colleagues to celebrate her extraordinary career. I especially want to welcome Judge Wood's husband, Dr. Robert Suffett, and her son, David Hutchinson, who is here. Welcome to both of you. We're delighted to have you. The legal community has been profoundly influenced by Judge Wood's decisions, her scholarship, teaching, and leadership over many years. I think this is clear to everyone who is here tonight, including her former students and clerks, as well as her colleagues from academia and from the bench. Judge Wood earned her BA from the University of Texas at Austin in 1971 and her JD from the University of Texas Law School in 1975, where she was an editor of the Texas Law Review and graduated with high honors and Order of the Coif. She joined the University of Chicago Law School faculty in 1981, becoming the third woman ever hired as a law professor at the school. This kind of trailblazing was, by that point, even then, not unfamiliar for Judge Wood, for previously she had served as a law clerk to Justice Blackmun, which made her among the first women ever to clerk at the Supreme Court. While she has held many roles at the University of Chicago, from Associate Dean to Harold J. and Marion F. Green Professor of International Legal Studies to Senior Lecturer, her role as an insightful scholar and dedicated mentor has remained constant. And we at the law school can testify that to firsthand because Judge Wood has participated in many events here over the years. She gave our Madison lecture on the classic question of whether courts should interpret the Constitution from an originalist or a dynamic approach, and she participated in our Rubin International Law Symposium, which focused on how U.S. courts balance domestic regulatory interest and the need for international cooperation in the context of transnational litigation. Judge Wood also delivered our Geordie Symposium lecture on the art of decision-making on a multi-member court. Her ability to thoughtfully consider all factors before writing a separate opinion, whether a concurrence or a dissent is one of her hallmarks featured in those remarks. All of these connecting points between NYU and Judge Wood reflect our basic commitment that every excellent legal mind is fundamentally a member of the NYU law faculty. Some of them just don't formally know that yet. Judge Wood is known widely for her ability to tactfully deal with others, including sometimes prickly and outspoken colleagues, not by giving up her own views, but by looking for common ground. She's built a reputation for her unique ability to craft thoughtful legal opinions that persuade judges from a variety of viewpoints, conservative and liberal alike, to support her well-reasoned interpretation of the law and adjudication of the facts. Judge Wood commands respect not through combativeness, grandstanding, or intimidation, but through sheer force of intellect. And it's that intellect we recognize tonight. Her career in academia and on the bench has been characterized by the strength of her convictions and of her character. And therefore, it's only fitting that our students decided to make her work the centerpiece of their most recent volume. I'd now like to turn the program over to this year's editor-in-chief of the annual survey, Yael Tzipori. Yael earned her BS in biology and psychology from Tufts University before joining us here at NYU Law. While at law school, she's worked as a research assistant to Professor Chase, whom you'll hear from shortly, and as a research assistant to Professor Ricky Revez, formerly of another title. Himself of many titles these days, including very soon director of the ALI, something still currently for a few days more at least held by another of our speakers this evening, Lance Liebman. After she graduates, Yael plans to join Sullivan and Cromwell as an associate in their general practice group. The journal really has had another spectacular year under her leadership, so I thank you and congratulate you and welcome you now to introduce Judge Wood. Is that right? Do I have it? Actually, we'll get to the introduction of Judge Wood, but first we'll have a number of remarks, starting with you.
Thank you, Dean Morrison. The dedication is a very special event at the annual survey, and we appreciate your support and your involvement tonight. Thanks also to Student Affairs, particularly Paul O'Grady and Tracy Noifor, for all your collaboration and your patience with me as I attempted to navigate the planning of this event. I'd also like to thank all of the student editors at the annual survey who made tonight possible. I'd especially like to thank Alex Gorman, who was the first person to put Judge Wood forward as a candidate, and I think it's evident from tonight that you made an excellent choice. As Dean Moore, yeah. No. Thanks, Gorman. As Dean Morrison mentioned, every year the student editors at the annual survey nominate an outstanding contributor to American legal scholarship, and we honor that person at a dedication ceremony held at the law school. We invite colleagues and friends to speak about the dedicatee, and we formally dedicate our upcoming volume to her. The dedication has been a tradition at annual surveys since the publication of our first volume in 1942. My small role in the ceremony is to offer a brief overview of the qualities and qualifications of Judge Wood that led our student committee to nominate her as the dedicatee of our 71st volume. I will leave any profound insights into the importance of her work and her career to the dedicators on stage, who are far more capable of doing so than me. Judge Wood was an early and favorite nominee among the students who brainstormed potential candidates for the dedication. She has the standout credentials of being an esteemed federal appellate court judge, a former clerk for a justice of the Supreme Court, a highly regarded faculty member at one of the top law schools in this country, and a leading contributor in numerous fields of legal scholarship, including antitrust law, constitutional law, and international trade and business. Our decision to nominate Judge Wood was made even more gratifying by the fact that we were able to dedicate our 71st volume to a woman who contributes so much to American law, since the annual survey had dedicated a volume to only one female legal scholar in the past 16 years. After our nomination became final, we were thrilled to learn that in October, Judge Wood became the first woman to serve as Chief Judge of the Seventh Circuit. As the only student speaking at tonight's ceremony, I felt some need to express a sense of what we as students can learn from Judge Wood's example as we embark on our own careers. I did a lot of reading over the past few weeks, and I was inspired by lessons that others have learned from Judge Wood's work and from her character. From her judicial career, that it's possible to articulately and resolutely stick to your principles, even when you hold a minority position, and that sometimes in seeking areas of common ground, you can persuade the majority to join your side. From those who have debated issues with her, that it is possible to disagree without being disagreeable. From Judge Wood herself, in an article on the University of Chicago Law School website, that the integrity of the position you hold can require you to call things as you see them. And from those who have worked with her, that listening to others and thoughtfully considering what they have to say is an effective way to garner consensus and be a successful leader. So if it isn't clear from that, I was inspired by Judge Wood in a very short amount of time and by means of a very limited connection. I am so grateful for the opportunity to hear more from all of you on stage who know her so well. Judge Wood, thank you for the honor of joining us here today. Everyone at the annual survey is grateful that you took the time to travel to New York and be a part of our tradition. I hope that you and all of our guests enjoy the program. That concludes my remarks, hence the awkward pause. And now it is my great honor to read a statement on behalf of Professor Eleanor Fox, who is also renowned for her work in antitrust law and is a close personal friend of Judge Wood's. Professor Fox couldn't be here in person, but we are grateful that she was willing to prepare a tribute for the ceremony. Professor Fox is the Walter J. Derenberg Professor of Trade Regulation here at NYU. Prior to joining the law school, she was a partner at the New York law firm Simpson, Thatcher & Bartlett. She has served as a member of the International Competition Policy Advisory Committee to the Attorney General of the U.S. Department of Justice under the Clinton administration, and as a commissioner on President Carter's National Commission for the Review of Antitrust Laws and Procedures. She has advised numerous foreign jurisdictions on antitrust matters, and she was awarded an inaugural Lifetime Achievement Award in 2011 by the Global Competition Review for substantial, lasting, and transformational impact on competition policy. Again, we are so happy to have received her contribution to today's ceremony. To Diane Wood on the occasion of the annual survey dedication. Diane has been a dear friend for 30 years, and it is my honor to add to the chorus and to congratulate Diane and her family, Rob, Katie, Jane, and David. And congratulations to the annual survey for the selection of the best honoree you could possibly choose. Diane is a Renaissance person and has contributed to so many fields in her scholarship, in her jurisprudence, and in arts and humanities. In considering her contributions to law, I will limit my remarks to antitrust and competition policy, while honoring her also for her broader contributions, including her constitutional jurisprudence, her international jurisprudence, and her sensitivities to inequalities, discrimination, and the human condition. But first, a personal note. Diane and I share a legal specialty, antitrust law and policy. This is only one small piece of the human being that is Diane, but it is what brought us together. Diane and I both like to teach in London and Paris in the University of San Diego summer law programs. On one or two occasions, we shared a course. She took the front end and I took the back end, or vice versa. We would cherish a few days of overlap, and I remember fondly the time we all met at the Louvre. All of Diane's children were there, and I remember sharing some moments with all of them, in particular David, before some great works of art. It never occurred to me that they would not be artistic and musical like their mother, and of course they are, among the myriad other things they do. I am one of countless admirers of Diane on the bench. I am always taken with the clarity and the humanity of her decisions, how she cuts through the legalisms and does what is wise and just in down-to-earth prose. She argues eloquently and tenaciously for good policy. Her opinions read like stories about real human beings, which of course they are, but which other jurists obscure. Diane has made enormous contributions to the very conception of competition law in a world of low barriers to trade, countless transborder transactions and transborder harms, and more than 100 national laws. She helped formulate and lead the debate of antitrust governance from the start. In the late 1980s and early 1990s, in the wake of a merger movement and strong winds of globalization, she and a British colleague, Richard Wish, were commissioned by the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development to study the growing body of transnational merger antitrust cases and to make recommendations. She and Richard produced a seminal study concluding with recommendations for cooperation that the OECD adopted. The OECD guidelines became one of the central documents for cooperation and competition authorities. In the early 1990s, the antitrust community robustly debated whether the world needs a global antitrust regime. Diane gave many speeches and wrote many articles about the future of antitrust in a globalized world. I have just reread her Fordham International Competition Conference paper of 1991, International Competition Policy in a Diverse World: Can One Size Fit All? and am struck with her wisdom and prescience, the timelessness of her words. The answer is, she said, one size could fit all, quote, but the fit might not be very comfortable, both because local conditions demand differential application of traditional antitrust rules, including, in my view, some that have fallen into disuse in the United States, and because different countries may simply wish to pursue additional policy goals, we are likely for some time to come to live with diversity of competition policy. The challenge in years to come will be to find the common elements and to build on them without losing sight of the differences in perspective and culture that inevitably exist." End quote. Not everyone agreed with Diane in 1991. I may have been the Don Quixote of her impossible dream Chicago Law Forum article in 1992. Almost everyone agrees with Diane today. Meanwhile, Diane was deputized by the Department of Justice Antitrust Division to create international antitrust guidelines. The guidelines were adopted several years later and were so sound and prescient when written that they are still a guiding document today. By 1993, when Diane became Deputy Assistant Attorney General in the Antitrust Division of the Department of Justice, the global merger movement was joined by what seemed to be a global cartel movement. Diane was deputy AAG when these changes were happening, and when insularity of competition authorities around the world made it easy to overlook global restraints or to be helpless before them. Diane traveled around the world not only as an inimitable substantive goodwill ambassador, but on a mission to transform positive comedy into antitrust law and policy, meaning that nations would help one another in their enforcement, especially in pursuing violations that occur on the soil of one nation and hurt consumers in another. She pioneered bilateral mutual assistance agreements to facilitate information exchanges subject to confidentiality. I would not be surprised if she created the now antitrust household concept, positive comedy. Diane's ideas and efforts laid the groundwork for the intense cooperation among competition authorities of the world today. Since Diane joined the Seventh Circuit bench, she has written remarkable decisions over the widest possible range of cases. Her antitrust jurisprudence, as all else, is remarkable and influential, the product of an unusually wise, thorough, caring, and clear-minded scholar and judge. She has rescued more than one case from the jaws of laissez-faire and myopia. In one, pushing against the tide of the ideological conviction that if a restraint is vertical, it must be free rider justified and efficient, she affirmed an FTC decision against Toys R Us for bullying its suppliers to keep hot toys out of the hands and boxes of the discount warehouse stores. In another, leaning against the tide of neo-isolationist conviction that foreign restraints are presumptively beyond the reach of the Sherman Act, she wrote the opinion for her court declaring that the U.S. potash buyers stated a cause of action against Canadian and Russian export cartelists who made their first price-fixed sale on foreign soil, foreseeing that a significant portion was destined for the U.S. market. She rejected the cramped claim that the U.S. harm was not direct and therefore failed the direct, substantial, and reasonably foreseeable requirement of the Foreign Trade Antitrust Improvements Act. Appreciating the larger canvas of antitrust coherence in the world, and mindful that export cartels risk falling through an enforcement gap, she said, quote, it is the U.S. authorities or private plaintiffs who have the incentive and the right to complain about overcharges paid as the result of the potash cartel and whose interests will be sacrificed if the law is not permitted to interpret this kind of case. Diane, you judge as you live with respect, conviction, commitment, and passion. I am thrilled to see this honor bestowed on you. Congratulations, with love, Eleanor.
Thanks, Al. So I will now come up in between each one of our next speakers to introduce them. Each one of them has had a career of such distinction that we could take up the rest of the evening just with the introduction. So I know they'll forgive me by moving more briefly than their careers truly merit. And I will start in that regard by introducing my distinguished colleague, Oscar Chase, who will be reading a dedication on behalf of himself and another distinguished colleague of ours, Sam Estreicher, who couldn't be here today. Oscar is the Russell Niles Professor of Law and co-director, together with Sam, of the Institute of Judicial Administration here at NYU. And Sam is our Dwight D. Opperman Professor of Law and co-director with Oscar. Both of them have received many more justly deserved accolades than that, but I will not enumerate all of them here, instead welcoming Oscar to give this dedication.
Thank you, Trevor. And so you can just imagine Sam Estreicher next to me and prompting me, or some kind of a Greek chorus. On behalf of Sam and myself, we're absolutely delighted to take part in this well-deserved tribute to Chief Judge Diane Wood. We thank the annual survey and its board for inviting us to do so. In addition to reading and learning from her opinions, books, and articles, and appearing with her at academic conferences, we've had the pleasure and honor to work with her in the service of judicial education for almost two decades. We share our colleague Richard Epstein's observation that she has, quote, the ideal judicial temperament. To date, it's not too much to say that Chief Judge Diane Wood is the learned hand of her generation, the Court of Appeals judge who, by reason of her personal intellectual qualities and judicial performance, is widely recognized as someone who would and should grace the Supreme Court of the United States. Chief Judge Wood consistently demonstrates that rare combination of keen analytical power, the ability and willingness to listen carefully to others, and the insistence that the case be decided on the merits, as free as possible from political or extraneous considerations. All persons, certainly all judges, have prior institutions about legal issues. We see the world, including the law, from the vantage of our shaping influence on our lives. The hard part for judges is to stand aside from those influences and approach the merits, even in controversial and hard cases, without prejudgment and with an open mind and ability to listen. Chief Judge Wood is at the top of our list and that of other close observers of the U.S. court system. Moreover, she enjoys and puts to effective use a capacity to perform, her duties as part of the team, which is the reality of the life of a Court of Appeals judge. And here I sound a theme that Trevor mentioned a few moments ago, except I enjoyed also the same article that you mentioned. But I'm going to, for the benefit of those who haven't seen it, mention the title, which is The Art of Decision Making, When to Hold, When to Fold, and When to Reshuffle. The Art of Decision-Making on a Multi-Member Court. And that put into my mind the thought, it must be quite intimidating to play poker with Chief Judge Wood. I'm not sure I'd be ready for that. Few judges are so persuasive across political and ideological lines that they can take issue with the members of a panel majority, a panel that includes intellectually confident colleagues, and managed to persuade the entire Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals en banc to unanimously adopt a different approach. Today's honoree has done so on several occasions. I'll skip the footnotes that underscore that statement. Chief Judge Wood, by the example of her temperament, the quality of her reasoning and judgment, can thus break down political and ideological rigidities and bring her court closer to the collegial professional ideal. Sam Estreicher and I have directed the NYU Appellate Judges Seminar as part of IJA's program for decades. The program is one of the centerpieces of IJA. Each summer, approximately 40 new appellate judges, including U.S. Court of Appeals, State Supreme, and State Appellate Court judges come to NYU for a week-long discussion of many facets of judging. A recurring topic for the annual program is the craft of judging, a session involving an experienced judge conveying to relatively new judges the indefinable ingredients of craft, principle, and effectiveness in judicial decision making. Chief Judge Wood is invariably one of the few people we turn to for this segment of the program, and she has taken part in no fewer than 10 summer's programs. We are grateful to her for this, and no good deed being unpunished. We are grateful to her and hope she will similarly honor us in future summers. For to our mind, she is a model of what a judge should be. We are proud of NYU's relationship with Chief Judge Diane Wood and applaud the annual survey for this great selection. Thank you.
Thanks, Oscar. Next is Geoff Stone, the Edward H. Levi Distinguished Professor of Law at the University of Chicago Law School, where he has previously served, of course, as Dean and Provost of the University of Chicago. In 2012, the American Constitution Society summed up Professor Stone's career by dubbing him a legal legend. They left out living, but I... They left out living, but I'm sure it was implied. It's a great privilege to have him with us here. So I give you Professor Stone.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here. When I was first invited to speak at today's event, I was instructed quite firmly that I was to limit myself to 7 minutes. 7 minutes? I assume this is a very small journal. By my calculation, 7 minutes represents 1 minute for every 5 years that Judge Wood and I have known one another, or more precisely, approximately 1 second per month. I can recall quite clearly when I first met Judge Wood. She was then a rather anxious applicant for a position on the faculty of the University of Chicago Law School. Thinking back on that meeting calls to mind an incident involving another of my favorite judges, Oliver Wendell Holmes. At the time of that particular incident, Holmes was a very old man, nearing 90 years of age. He was in the autumn of his very long and distinguished career. On that particular occasion, Holmes was on a train headed north from Washington. He was deeply engrossed in reading a legal brief when the conductor knocked on the door to his compartment, and recognizing Holmes, the conductor respectfully asked for his ticket. Holmes looked in his coat pocket, but no ticket. He looked in his vest pocket, but no ticket. He reached into his trouser pockets, but no ticket. Growing ever more frantic, Holmes began rummaging desperately through his briefcase, but still, no ticket. At this point, the conductor, trying to calm Holmes, said, never mind, Mr. Justice, it's really not a problem. When you find the ticket, you can just mail it into the company. To which Holmes exploded, you dolt, I don't give a damn about your ticket. I just want to know where the hell I'm supposed to be going. So this story is arguably relevant. Because when I first met Diane, as a would-be assistant professor of law, she too had no idea where she was supposed to be going. But somehow or other, as we can see today, she did manage to get there. One of the great pleasures of my service as dean of the University of Chicago Law School was the opportunity to work closely with Diane for the 3 years she served as my associate dean. During those years, Diane was my closest colleague, my wisest advisor, my most discreet confidant, and perhaps most important, my constant friend. One of the great privileges of my deanship was the opportunity to recommend Diane for appointment as the Harold J. and Marion F. Green Professor in International Legal Studies. This was a privilege not only because it was an honor to recognize Diane's accomplishments in this regard, but also because she was the first woman ever appointed to a named professorship in the history of the University of Chicago Law School, and indeed a great example. Diane has, however, disappointed me in one very important way. I have always hoped that Diane one day would become dean of the University of Chicago Law School. Indeed, on several occasions over the years, I have tried to convince her that she should take on this responsibility, but always she has demurred. I have to say, it never occurred to me that she would instead go on to become a judge. Now, that's not dean of the University of Chicago Law School, but it's something. She is indeed now one of the most distinguished and most respected judges in the United States. Even our colleagues from the University of Chicago Law School, who serve with her on the Seventh Circuit, Richard Posner and Frank Easterbrook, two men who like nothing, are eloquent when they speak of Judge Wood, even though they, of course, often disagree with her. Now, I've, of course, followed Judge Wood's career on the bench over the past almost two decades quite closely. She has been and she continues to be an extraordinary jurist. She is careful, precise, intellectually honest, principled, courageous, forthright, and fair. She has a great eye for the essential balance between doctrine and good sense. It is indeed what makes her such a brilliant judge. I'll briefly mention three of Judge Wood's opinions to illustrate the nature of her commitment to the rule of law and her good sense. In one case decided in 1997, plaintiffs filed an action under the Fair Housing Act, asserting that the defendants had used racially discriminatory advertisements for an upscale apartment house on Lakeshore Drive to drive African Americans away from the building. The defendants won at the trial. After carefully reviewing the record, Judge Wood ordered a new trial because, in her words, the judgment below was, quote, the product of errors that riddled the trial from start to finish. The trial judge, she observed, consistently allowed defense counsel to treat the plaintiff's lawyers in a sexist and demeaning way. In a rather direct manner, Judge Wood declared that we have nothing good to say about the tone of this trial. Personal attacks on counsel and remarks that disparage others on the basis of race or sex have no place in the courtrooms of this circuit. In 2002, Judge Wood filed a dissenting opinion in an important abortion case involving the constitutionality of an Indiana law that required a woman seeking an abortion to be informed in person of the state's warnings about the procedure, rather than allowing her to read a brochure or to look at a website. The effect of the law was to require a woman to make two separate trips to the clinic or to the hospital in order to have an abortion. Although the majority upheld the law, Judge Wood wrote a powerful and persuasive opinion, arguing that the in-person two-visit requirement served no legitimate interest in maternal health or in protecting potential life. And it was designed in practical effect to make it more difficult for a woman to exercise her constitutional right to terminate an unwanted pregnancy. That being so, she concluded, the challenge statute posed an undue burden on the rights of the woman and was therefore unconstitutional. And in this, she was, in my judgment, absolutely correct. In 2008, Judge Wood again wrote a compelling dissenting opinion in a case involving a condominium association. This time involved a rule preventing a Jewish resident from displaying a mezuzah on the doorpost of her unit. The majority argued that the challenge rule did not discriminate against the plaintiff on account of her religion because it was a neutral policy that banned all images and figurines on doorposts. Judge Wood pointed out that the rule was not, in fact, neutral once it was examined beyond its face. This was so, she said, because the rule applied to doorposts was immaterial to all other residents, and its sole force and its sole purpose was, in fact, to discriminate against the Jewish owner. As an analogy, Judge Wood noted that a similar situation would arise if a rule forbade women to wear headscarves in the common areas of a condominium. No one but observant Islamic women would, of course, be under a religious duty to do this, and it would therefore be reasonable to infer that such a rule intentionally discriminates against persons of one religion, even though it may appear superficially to be neutral. As I said, Judge Wood brings not only great intellect to her role, but common and good sense as well. I'm delighted to have this opportunity to say to my friend Diane, on the occasion of this celebration of her extraordinary achievements, and in the spirit of the mezuzah case, Mazel Tov.
Thank you, Jeff. The question, I think, for Chief Judge Wood is if the annual survey had committed to dedicating each one of its volumes to a law dean, would she have made the career decision differently? We'll never know. Next is Ross Davies, a professor of law at George Mason University School of Law, where he teaches torts, contracts, and legal history. Ross is known to many of us not just for his scholarship, but for his singular entrepreneurship in law. He is the source of the green bag, the bobblehead dolls of the justices of the Supreme Court, and more recently, the baseball card career statistics devices for members of the court as well. It turns out the most important of his credentials, though, is that of former law clerk to Chief Judge Wood, and we welcome him here today.
Thank you, Trevor. Thank you, Yael.
Sure, thank you.
This is not high tech. Paul is high tech, I am not. Do we have any law students here? Current law students? Very good. Okay, thank you. As I proceed, when you think that what I'm saying rings a bell with a case you've studied in law school, just raise your hand. Practically from the start of her service on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Seventh Circuit, Judge Diane Wood, now Chief Judge, has been justly recognized as an extraordinary judge, influential, effective, and just. Unfortunately, much of what I could share with you about her, I learned as a clerk. And while it may well be appropriate for a former clerk to a judge who is no longer active to tell tales, I really can't tell you most of the good stuff. And if I had to guess, I'd say I'm at least 30, 40, 50 years away from having that opportunity, just based on energy and toughness of the subject. So there are limits, however, to proper clerical silence, or at least my capacity to keep my mouth shut. And so I am going to share something. It's not about a case, and it's not actually particularly significant. But it does, I think, say something significant about Judge Diane Wood. And so here it is. Her start on the court was, in fact, brilliant. She hit the ground running and immediately was making an impact, not just in the Seventh Circuit, but nationwide. And there was one problem. All right, young people. Her commission was not delivered. Dean Morrison, you're... No hands? Okay, very good. Now, this is the counterfactual historical question of the night. How much different would this country be today if William Marbury had Diane Wood's backbone, right? Because what happened was her commission got shipped from DC to Chicago, and it did arrive at 219 South Dearborn Street. But then, and anyone who's been involved in remodeling knows how this goes, her chambers are being fixed up because she's the new judge. And somewhere along the way, some well-intentioned person apparently recycled her commission. And so she's without a commission, but as we know from Marbury versus Madison, she is not without a judgeship. But unlike Marbury, and this isn't just about technology and telephones, unlike Marbury, she picked up the telephone, she called the president, and she said, send me a new commission. And yes, and lo and behold, the new commission came. So don't mess with Judge Wood, right? Yes. But notwithstanding all of that, there was still a problem. And the problem was that this commission was not quite the same as the one she first received. If you look at the bottom of this commission, and you'll get a closer look soon enough, don't worry. If you look at the bottom of this commission, and I had an opportunity to do this because the whole rigmarole about this commission occurred as I was coming on board as her clerk. The redecorating was getting done, and this second commission, which by the way had been hidden on a high shelf behind a row of books in her small private office, safe from prying GSA hands. So it's there. I'm there in chambers, maybe for the first time. I can't remember that closely, but it's flat. It's not framed. It's lying flat on her desk to get the curve of the cardboard tube out of it. And there, on this magnificent document, right at the very bottom, in tiny type, tiny italic type, it says, duplicate. And below that, in even tinier type, it says Bureau of Engraving and Printing. And I've done a little bit of research on this. This whole process of how these things get made is something of a mystery. But it is a sufficiently common event that they've got a system for doing these things. And it was into that system that her request went and this commission comes out. So there are a lot of these things out there, or at least a substantial number. But there's this word duplicate at the bottom. But it's so small and it's so close to the bottom. It's clear that it's like fine print, right? It's FYI, the recipient, and then when you mat it and frame it, of course, no one will see that you have a duplicate, right? So there we are in her private office, and we're looking at this thing, and now I will engage in just a moment of unimaginative reconstruction. There are no quotation marks in this because my memory isn't that good, but bear with me. Wood. I am glad to have the commission, of course, but I am at a loss as to how I ought to put it on the wall. Davies. What do you mean? Now, parenthetically here, just so we understand each other, okay? Those were not my actual words. I am sure that I said a lot more words, and they were very deferential and admiring and so on and so forth, because I was her new clerk, right? You know, if I were the me of today, and if I knew her as well at that moment as I do now, I would have said, well, you know, 4 thumbtacks should be fine for this, right? But I was not that strong then. And so I just said something like, what do you mean, Your Honor, in all your wisdom, right? And what she said, though, was, I mean, this is a duplicate commission, and I want to display it so that the word duplicate is visible. I do not want to conceal it. Davies, because you don't want people to think you're hiding something? No, says Wood. That would be silly. I'm feeling even smaller now, right? Yes. It's because I do not want it to appear to be something other than what it is. I simply want to be accurate. Pause. Wood again. But I doubt it will look right in a frame. I don't know if they can even frame it properly to show the duplicate. Remember, it's very close to the bottom, right? Davies. True. Another pause, right? Wood. And this actually may ring a bell with someone. I don't know. Enough. It will look odd, but it will be right. We'll see. And that was the end of it. And I don't think it occurred to anyone to try to do anything about this, because it was so obvious that this was just routinely the way it was done. The Bureau of Engraving and Printing has been producing these things for more than a century. They know what they're doing. This is a routine thing. And so we're stuck with this duplicate commission with the words in the right place for everyone else, but the wrong place for Judge Diane Wood, right? And so a few weeks later, the thing does in fact show up with the word duplicate on display. And she was correct, it is funny looking. Okay, good, we're in good shape at the moment. In fact, it has a special kind of funny lookingness. It looks funny at any distance. If you look at it from far away, from across the room, it looks lopsided on the vertical axis. The text is too close to the top of the frame. There's not much, there's a regular amount of white space at the top and way too much at the bottom. Or if you get closer, say, you know, as far as I am from Judge Wood right now. Let's see if we can make this work. Okay? Now it looks like there's some sort of smudge, right? Or tear. Can you see this thing? There's this. What is this down here? And there's a black line right along the frame. This is not the way, this is the second most important document in her life. And it doesn't look right. And then if you get even closer, you can see. It says duplicate. And you can see about two-thirds of Bureau of Engraving and Printing. The framing people, these are not the framers who we admire, right? These are the other framers, okay? They just, maybe they do have something in common. They get it almost right, right? But not quite. And so we're missing a bit of Bureau of Engraving and Printing because they had their orders, right? They had to have the word duplicate show, but it doesn't show quite right. I do not want to overstate, however, and you can see for yourself, overstate the peculiarity of this. I mean, it is obviously what it is, right? It is a presidential commission. Other than the little bit at the bottom, it looks like the original did, exactly like the original did. Nor do I want to exaggerate the weightiness of the moment where she made this decision. This was very quick. That little exchange meant a great deal to me, and she has a very good memory. She probably remembers it, but I don't think it had made a deep impression on her. I know my comments didn't make a deep impression on her. It was quick but unhurried. This was a no-brainer. The right and the wrong of it were easy. It was a simple principle. I want to be accurate. There's nothing preventing me from being accurate except a little funny-lookingness, and that's hardly a good enough reason. So what we have is this ugly duckling, right? That is really a thing of beauty. This is the homeliest judicial commission in America, right? And it is the handsomest. It is the only commission that is in itself a reflection of the kinds of qualities that we admire in great judges. She sees things as they are, not as we might wish them to be, right? And she goes with those sensibilities, regardless of whether it's the easiest, the cleanest, the prettiest solution. And so she, I imagine, alone in America, has a duplicate commission and is proud of it. I won't beat this, too much to death because the story does speak for itself. This is a res ipsa kind of thing. Does this ring a bell with anyone? Yes? Yes? Okay. But I will close with one related observation, and that is this, that her little exercise in openness creates a nice symmetry of judicial symbolism, you might say. She has her robes, and they, to some extent, conceal and constrain her. That is part of what the robes do for us as we interact with the judge. And that is part of what they do to her as she wears them. But she also has this duplicate commission, which leaves her with a choice, right, between concealment and disclosure. But concealment to what end? To look better, to be neater, to paper or frame over a messiness in government administration, to avoid the risk that some not quite perfectly informed observer might misunderstand the meaning of the word duplicate in this context. Or disclosure to what end? To share what can reasonably be shared, to hide only what must be hidden, to honor the democratic default rule of openness. These are small, tiny, perhaps practically insignificant choices in this context, right? But it is by them, as well as by her judicial acts, that we know her and admire her. Okay, now what do I do? Yes, well, that I can do, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. Terrific. Our final dedicator this evening is Lance Liebman, professor at Columbia Law School, former dean of Columbia Law School, longtime director of the ALI, soon to be succeeded by the former dean of this law school. Lance, I will say, is among all of those other things as well, a dear former colleague of mine and good friend, and we're very glad to have him here this evening.
Trevor, thank you. Somehow this reminded me, I hadn't been thinking about this, of a recent introduction that I heard. It was the 125th anniversary of the Yale Daily News, where I was once the editor-in-chief or whatever it was called. But I was not the speaker at this event. The speaker was my cousin, a very famous cousin I have. Many of you will have known his work. Writes under the name Calvin Trillin, whole career at The New Yorker, lives around the corner here, whatever. Bud Trillin, as we call him in the family. And a student now on the Yale Daily News got up and introduced Bud and went kind of on and on. And then Bud got up and he said, I forget the kid's name, you know, that was an okay introduction, but you could have done much, much better. And you should have just used four words. And the four words would have been, not since Mark Twain. And so what Trevor should have said just now is not until Ricky Revesz. So what I've been sitting there thinking is that after Trevor and Sam and Oscar and Jeff, there was really nothing a lot more to say about the wonderful Judge Wood. The last speaker just proved that. But he solved the problem. I don't really have a solution. And one of the problems is that Trevor opened this up by reading my remarks, and I was wondering where he got them. And then I realized that Jeff Stone has had a recent experience that has led him to be able to get my emails. I think he shared it with Trevor. The only thing, I'm going to be short because we want to get to the real speaker. The way I was thinking of it is that we should think of Judge Wood in terms of four I's, okay, letter I's. Not E-Y-E, but the letter I. And one is intellectual, and she is a very, very high-class intellectual person. That's true in her opinions. It's true in her vast academic and judicial writings, and et cetera. I came prepared to talk about the Madison lecture, but I think I will spare you some of that. Some of it's been said and whatever. But intellectual is the first word. The second, which has been fully discussed, I think, is interpersonal, and she does have a very high level of willingness and ability to deal with human beings, to fit them together. I think her ability to achieve unanimity in the Seventh Circuit has been somewhat exaggerated based on the two experiences in however many years this is, but she is terrific with people. The third I would call institutional, and it's an ability to function in the units, the institutions that we collectively need to do things. And my great happiness has been my ability to get help from Judge Wood in terms of the American Law Institute, a very complicated and institution and one with a lot of tension up at the high end. For instance, my boss is Roberta Ramo, who was the first woman to be president of the ABA and now president of the ALI. Roberta's a lawyer in Albuquerque. We have fierce fights on the telephone about what is the worst governed state. And Roberta, no matter what I say about the horrors of Albany and New York, you see, I'm now on this Moreland Commission and things are real bad. And there's Peter Zimroth, who tries to guide and get something out of this experience. And so far, he has not been a success. Exactly. But when I say that, Roberta comes back with stories about New Mexico that are unbelievable. Now, sometimes Chicago gets in this game, and the state of Illinois. Massachusetts has three recent speakers of their lower house in prison, and things like that. But to be serious, at the ALI, Diane has been a tremendous help and support, and made a very complicated institution work better. And of course, the selection of the new director, which naturally done by a committee chaired by Diane, is the latest way she has contributed. Some of you have read about how she's the one called in to fix the American Academy of Arts and Sciences when they crashed, and this takes a lot of effort and a lot of ability and a huge amount of energy. The fourth, which you heard about, read by Lael, is international, and she was very early as a legal intellectual in this country. I don't mean she was first, but she was very early to realize how international the world of how law is becoming so much more of an international matter, and the increase in that over the years since I was in law school, let's say, has been amazing. I just remember as a young Harvard teacher, and I'd been there a few years, but I hadn't been out of the country, and somebody called me and they said there's going to be a meeting in Birmingham, and I said, Alabama or England? And they said, England. And I said, I'll come. Then there are two things about this. The way it broke, and we had little kids, and there was a lot of taking care of kids stuff and all this. But so I had to fly overnight just before the meeting through the night, to Heathrow, and then get a bus or a train or something to Birmingham. So it was, I'd been up all night basically. And I thought I did great at this meeting. I really thought I did great. And then now the photos would have been circulated, half an hour after the meeting ended. But it was like 2 months later, I got in the mail a picture, and there were all these very important people plus me, around a table, and my head was on the table fast asleep. That is a true story. And Diane, and the other thing about that trip was, there I was at Harvard Law School, and I said, I got to go to the bank. I was at lunch with some of my colleagues, a couple of whom were international, like Von Meren, Baxter, people like that. And I said, I got to go down to the bank and get my passport out of the safe deposit box. They looked at me like I was an idiot. Their passports were always ready. They were going to go to the airport this afternoon on short notice. But anyway, Diane's international involvement has been tremendous. I say that now at a very interesting moment because some of you don't know this, of course. There has just opened the European Law Institute, exactly on the model of the American Law Institute, and taking our bylaws and everything else, and they just had their first annual meeting and things like that. And so that's just another one of 100 signs of what Diane has known for a long time, and her intellectual work about especially antitrust law, but also trade law and procedural issues in the international context have been tremendous. So let me just say that I think a very, very terrific choice was made to honor Diane. As my final words, I just want to disagree with what you said. When you said no women have gotten only one in 16 years or something, that was a careful calculation when in a 5-year period the winners were Judith Kaye, Hillary Clinton, Sandra O'Connor, Ruth Ginsburg, and Janet Reno. I mean, Diana's walking in impressive shoes, and she fills them completely.
On behalf of the NYU Annual Survey of American Law, we would like to formally dedicate our 71st volume to you on behalf of all of your contributions to American law.
Thank you. very hard to know what to say other than thank you many, many times over. Certainly thank you to the journal and Yael and all of the students on the journal for this selection. Thank you to Trevor. Many, many thanks to all of you with all of those undeserved comments, you know, Lance and Ross and Jeff and Oscar and Sam in absentia and Eleanor and all of you. I couldn't possibly appreciate it more. And it's a strange feeling, actually, to sit there and listen to people and reviewing what you've done, since obviously, like all of us, I go to work every day and I do what seems to me the right thing to do with that day and hope that it somehow all adds up into something worthwhile at the end. You know, and you know, Lance is right. You know, you don't change the world with every case, but truthfully, there is a lot that goes on before that even panel opinion comes out. And I think we have a court, partly actually because of the culture of all three of us from the University of Chicago, that values discussion with one another. It's not just me, it's everybody on the court who is willing to sit down, thrash through a case, think about it when agreement doesn't seem very easy, maybe to go back to the drawing board and see if there's some other way we can approach it. Sometimes that's not true. More often, as I pointed out in the when to hold, when to fold lecture, it actually is true. The rate of dissent and separate opinion writing throughout the country on the courts of appeals is not that high. It's, you know, it's 5% of cases, or maybe even not quite that, maybe 3%. And I did a count of my own cases, and it's not more than that. So certainly my work on the court has been amazing. And I want to say to the students here that one of the things I hope has come through is how incredibly rich the law itself is as a field to study. I've been congenitally unable to pick a particular area for myself, because every time I think something like, you know, oh, international antitrust must be the most interesting thing there is, I love this, I'm really gonna devote a lot of time to it, all of a sudden I get lured over and I think, oh, I know, but actually procedure is really very cool, and I'm going to work with that. And it's one of the nice things about working with an organization like the ALI, where people are doing so many different things all at once, or being associated with a school like the University of Chicago, you really do get to keep up at least with everything, even if certainly no one, definitely not me, is an expert in all of it. So I hope that the students here and everybody will take that as a challenge and realize that there are links to be made that you may not have thought were possible, and just fun in keeping up with everything. And clearly the importance, you know, it's a real privilege, I should absolutely say, being on the court, dealing with real people, real lives, real problems, and hoping, of course, in each case that you get it right, but not having the luxury of saying, oh, what an interesting problem, I'll think about it some more. No, you actually have to say, you win, you lose, you know, this is gonna happen, that's not gonna happen, you get to pay $1 billion, you don't. So, and I'm not kidding, you know, the stakes can be that big. Or my personal recent favorite case, you know, dealing with the watersheds of the Mississippi River and the Great Lakes, to which I've been giving a lot of thought lately, and trying to remind myself that federal judges are not necessarily the most expert in every field, although some of our colleagues sometimes wish that we were, maybe, I'll just say, but those of us who've been doing this for a while recognize that we owe a huge debt to all of you. We owe a huge debt to the bar, to the experts, to everyone who comes before us. This has been touching beyond all belief to me. I just feel so fortunate in my friendship with so many people at NYU Law School. I've always felt welcome when I've come here. I think Sam Estreicher actually twisted my arm, and I will be coming back this summer briefly. Sam's very effective and doesn't like taking no for an answer. So I look forward to many more years of close association with the law school, and thank all of you for coming.
Well, thank you, Judge, for agreeing to be our honoree this year. We're really thrilled about that. I want to take this last moment to congratulate the students at the annual survey for their terrific work, and all of you for being here, and to invite you to join us for a reception here on this end of the room. Thank you again.